Dr. Laverne McCummings, Dr. Betty McCummings, Dr. Vernon Clark, faculty, administrators, guests, and fellow students. I am Cheryl Bowie, a graduating senior majoring in Recreation and Leisure Studies. This semester, I completed my internship at Fair Acres Geriatric Center in Lima, Pennsylvania. I learned, assisted, and implemented activities in the Therapeutic Activity Services Department. During my internship, I gained knowledge of many processes of geriatric activities and care. One in specific I would like to share with you tonight. I have selected the topics of sensory stimulation and sensory training techniques as the basis for my senior exit project. Our senses are the means through which our bodies experience stimuli, both inside and outside of our bodies. Sensory organs, the skin, eyes, ears, nose, and mouth, pick up information given by the stimuli and passes it on to the brain. Once in the brain, the information is collected and put into categories, thus resulting in a sensory experience. Sensory deprivation occurs when any of these sense organs are not able to receive the stimuli or when the signals given cannot be processed by the brain. Each person needs varying levels of stimulation in order, varying levels of stimulation in order to receive the stimuli. Often the amount of stimulation is proportional to one's age. Interaction with the sensory deprived older adult can be hindered or helped by the environment. Activities of sensory stimulation is one of the best ways to provide needed stimuli in a long-term care facility. Activities can be structured to elicit responses from the five senses. The sensory training. Sensory training is a group or individual experience which involves all five senses. Its aim is to provide stimuli which improves the perception of and response to both the physical and human environments. Sensory training was developed in 1968 by Leona Richmond while Director of Occupational Therapy at Bronx Psychiatric Center. It is geared to the more regressed patient who have little opportunity for activity or group participation. It aims to combat the varying effects of social, physical, and psychological breakdown in the more regressed geriatric patient. This is done by either maintaining present level or avoiding further decompensation. Simple body awareness exercises and sensory stimuli are presented to, experienced, and understood by the patients. There should be between 5 and 7 patients in a group. There should also be a balance of verbal and nonverbal members. A group consists of members who are at the same level of functioning, though not all have to be at the same level of regression. The best time for sensory stimulation has been in the morning, since the patients are generally more well-rested and more alert. Initial sessions should be short because of the attention span and the unfamiliarity with the group experience. The time of day may also have to be modified to allow for group, institutional, and organization differences. The group should meet in the same place every time. The room should be quiet, comfortable, and well-lit. It should be also out of the way as to not have interferences by staff. No special materials are needed for sensory training. Simple everyday items may be used. The primary factor here is the leader's creativity and interest. The leader is responsible for establishing a friendly, non-threatening atmosphere. The leader should accept each patient as they are and emphasize their abilities and contributions by reinforcing the right responses. Eye contact should be used as much as possible. Group leaders with a warm quality and who can touch their patients have been found to be very successful in the sensory training technique. The first part of the technique consists of orientation. The leader greets each individual member by name and introduces each member to the rest of the group. Name tags worn by the leader and patients may be helpful. After greeting each member, the group is oriented to the time and place. The purpose of the meeting is given, and the leader may outline the benefits and why everyone should do as they are asked. The second segment consists of body awareness exercises. During this portion of the session, different body joints are identified. The major purpose of this is to give patients a sense of body awareness and to explain the importance of using the joints on the body. The third segment involves actual sensory stimulation. In this phase, the five senses and the corresponding sensory organs are identified. The senses are stimulated by a variety of props given by the leader to the group members. The leader encourages appropriate responses by phrasing questions according to each level, each individual's level. When a patient does respond to a presented stimulus, the leader repeats the verbal response for all to hear. If the response is nonverbal, the leader repeats this answer also. May I have three volunteers, please, for this next portion? Touch. Providing touch allows one to know that he exists with others. A genuine touch will acknowledge and affirm. Simple techniques, simple things that we use in actual sensory training can be as simple as Play-Doh. Okay. You just play with that and make a ball for me. Things like this, they may be simple to you and I, but often people cannot do them. Often, clothespins. You can just have them clip them around the basket. And for patients who do not have use of their hands, we can also take a little lotion and massage, thus providing that much needed human touch. This is an example of things that I have found that have been helpful in actual sensory stimulation. Thank you. Auditory stimulation, the sense of hearing. Hearing is the second major sense. It involves detecting pitch, intensity, and the time interval between sounds. Impaired hearing often reduces an individual's capacity for interacting successfully with his environment. The elderly lose ability to hear high pitches, and it is easier for them to hear lower tones even if they have a softer volume. Individuals can worsen their limitations by becoming withdrawn and isolating themselves from others. The elderly often rely on eye contact and body language in order to decipher what is being communicated to them. For better communication, face the person at a close distance, speak slowly and distinctly, raise volume, and make use of facial expression and body gesture. Use one. Two. Joe, can you tell me which one was the loudest? The third one, this one. And what about this one? The softest. Do you agree with him, Mark? That is correct. Thank you. Variety of props. Can you tell me what this is, Mark?
An envelope.
Okay. Joe, an ice cream cone. And be careful, this one is not as sticky to the spoon. Okay, taste it. Someone tell me what that was. Lemon. Okay. Taste. Okay, Roy.
Pineapple.
Okay. That concludes it, gentlemen. Thank you. Sensory stimulation, which uses sensory training, is a valuable process which serves to bring patients back into touch with their surroundings. The technique of sensory training, which was developed in 1968, has since been modified to allow for vast individual and group differences. The purposes of my paper was to give an overview of the sensory stimulation and sensory training processes. It explains how our five senses are affected by the aging processes and shows how sensory stimulation can be used effectively to hinder further decompensation. Sensory stimulation can truly be a great experience for both leader and patient alike, but there are no special tools to ensure that one does benefit from the session. The leader must rely on their knowledge and not always the resources in order to find out what is beneficial in treatment and what is not. For all that sensory stimulation does, it may also be noted that it is used to combat the effects of physical, social, and psychological breakdown by actually breaking down the environment into its most simple form. This breakdown is necessary and beneficial to the patient who may have regressed to the point where actual sensory stimulation may be needed to bring the patient back into touch with reality. My personal experiences in sensory stimulation has afforded me great opportunities to expand the knowledge which I have gained from textbooks. Sensory training cannot always be implemented as it should, but the main factor here is that some form of sensory stimulation is being done to avoid decompensation. It is being done to improve the perceptions of and responses to the stimuli in one's environment. Thank you. I don't have any saunas or pools there, but in physical therapy, they often have them stand for exercises with the knees and legs. Any other questions? Sorry. Thank you.
Pleasure to introduce Ms. Catherine Murray. She has likewise done her field placement this past semester at Fair Acres Geriatric Center. And in addition to that, is supervisor of recreation at the Slayton School in Lima, Pennsylvania. Catherine also has participated in many organizations on campus. She has been the vice president of the Recreation Majors Club, as well as a Red Cross volunteer, a member of Foster Parents of Delaware County, and a member of the Youth Advocacy Program of Delaware County. On campus, Catherine's honors and awards include the Act 101 Achievement, Academic Achievement Award, as well as the academic recognition list, along with being a Dean's List member. And in 1988, she was the Richard Humphrey Scholar. Catherine's job objective is to receive a challenging position in a medical hospital, juvenile detention center, or a nursing home specializing in therapeutic recreation or a similar discipline. You, I present Ms. Catherine Murray, who will give her presentation on remotivation.
Good evening, President Tony, Dr. Clark, faculty, fellow students, and guests. My name is Catherine Murray, a graduate of senior major recreation. I would like to share with you my work through your exit project. The topic I chose to discuss is remotivation. As defined by the National Remotivation Technique Organization, remotivation is a technique of simple group therapy of an objective nature used with a group of patients in an effort to reach the unwanted areas of patients' personality and to get them thinking about reality in themselves. Remotivation differs from other therapies. It focused on the patient's abilities rather than her disabilities. In 1951, a study was conducted at McGill University to examine the efforts of a prolonged monotonous stimuli on young healthy subjects. Upon removal from an environment from which all pattern stimuli were removed, the subjects reported that they could not think clearly, visually, auditory, and te- tactile hallucinations have been experienced, and tests indicated that their visual perception was severely distorted. It appears that sensory stimulation has general functions of maintaining arousal in the brain and can rapidly lose this power of arousal if stimulation is restricted to which, as mononosity reported, repeated in an unchanging environment. Remotivation is also beneficial to the remotivator. It provides the remotivator a flexible structure in which to work with patients and gives him or her an opportunity to get to know them personally and share their experiences with the group. Remotivation was originated by Dorothy Hopkins Smith. She worked at a VA hospital in Connecticut. She worked as a volunteer. From this experience, the technique evolved. The technique was limited to one or two hospitals. Remotivation training teams were sent out to various hospitals throughout the country. Ms. Smith was brought to Philadelphia at the request of Southeastern Chapter of Mental Health Education Unit of Pennsylvania by Smith, Klein, and French Laboratories. Increased interest in the technique from other hospitals led to this formation. Remotivation Advisory Committee of American Psychiatric Association. The committee worked with Smith, Klein, and French in initiating plans to establish a remotivation program throughout the country. One of the first hospitals involved in the training was Philadelphia State Hospital. Philadelphia State Hospital personnel was sent to 40 states and to present week-long training sessions. As a result of the training sessions, over 15,000 nurses and psychiatric aides had participated in their training by the end of 1967. To facilitate future expansion, remotivation regional training centers were established by 1960. A proposal was
Chairperson, faculty, staff, and honored guests. My name is Keisha Colbert. I'm a senior at Cheyney University. And while I did my internship at Fair Acres, the biggest thrill to me was when they did clown therapy. I had the opportunity to watch one of the task people, therapeutic activity specialists, feed, actually have a tube feeder eat with a spoon. And the tube feeder has the tubes that go up their nose and into their stomach. And the main purpose was to get the tube feeders to actually do for themselves. And while we're in a clown outfit, she was able to do that. I'm going to tell you a little about the history of clowning and where it originates. A clown is a divine spirit to rejoice and delight the heart. According to a 9-year-old Egyptian pharaoh who heralded the first recorded appearance of a clown around 2270 BC. The comic spirit of a clown exists in just about every known culture. It is as old as civilization. This ancient craft speaks to which is all human in us. The Western tradition of clowning can be traced to ancient Greece, where you can see strolling sponges portraying everyone from soldiers, fools, witches, slaves, and Greek gods. Throughout the Middle and Early Renaissance, jesters and fools perpetuated the art of clowning. Also during this period, the colorful costume was associated with today's clowns in its beginning.